In India, weddings are a cultural phenomenon. Elaborate venues, intricate clothes, though representative of a small and elite section of society, these spectacles are known to go on for days, cost a lifetime of savings, and famously feed hundreds of guests. It is one of the most lucrative industries in the country, but also one that took a huge hit during the pandemic. This is what the big fat Indian wedding looks like now. There's sanitizer on the plate, matching brocade face masks for the bridesmaids, and PPE kits for the hotel staff. In New Delhi, where the weddings are big and the guest lists bigger, the wedding halls are now empty.
The wedding industry in India was pegged at about 3.5 lakh crores in terms of spend. After the pandemic, almost 70% of the wedding market has got eroded. You're talking about almost 2.5 lakh crores gone. I would say at least 1 crore jobs have been lost. That's 10 million. Every bit of expenditure has got affected. Every bit of service has got affected. The jewelry market has got affected. The trousseau market has got affected. If you look at the pure mainstream Chandni Chowk areas of Delhi, even they have taken a hit because of negative demand curve in the wedding market. Till about June or July, there was no movement, there was no activity. What exactly happened was that we started getting queries from some of our clients. So July onwards, this trend started taking place and it started picking up, where of course these intimate weddings, so-called, about 50, 100, 150, 200 people started picking up.
Arushi and Anand are one of the couples who decided to take the plunge right in the middle of the pandemic.
What was your favorite memory from the wedding?
My favorite wedding memory, I would say, is when we walked in together.
Oh yeah.
It was also incredibly dramatic because of this whole Zoom thing was happening. We had to start at 8 p.m. dot. And it's 8 p.m. and I'm there, I'm greeting her family and everybody that's coming in, and Arushi is not picking up my phone.
And
then I don't know where she is, and I'm texting her. I don't know where you were in the process of getting
ready. So I sent a message at around 5 p.m. saying, I'm starting my hair and makeup, I don't have my phone now. Also, interestingly, the thing with my makeup artist is that I found somebody I really liked, booked her, and then she found out that her domestic help and her husband may have contracted COVID. Had to cancel that and didn't know where to go. But then she found out that her husband actually was a false positive and he was negative after multiple tests. So on the day of the wedding at 2 p.m. I said, hey, will you still come? And she's like, sure, I'll come. And that's why I was very dramatic. I was really late. To be very honest, we had planned our wedding like a year in advance because we had a fixed idea of how we wanted it and we wanted to minimize parental control on our idea of the wedding. And also to some extent, because we were getting married in end October, we were very, very hopeful and optimistic that by then things would have calmed down. I think that optimism that we had kind of carried us through till June, July. And then by then we were like, okay, maybe it's not going to get better. So let's just adapt and go ahead with what we can. The wedding was always supposed to be small, but more Indian small, which is 200 people. We were going to have a civil marriage, but a small, maybe Varmala. And then two receptions, which our parents could throw and invite their friends.
Gatherings about 200, 300 people. So that all sort of went away.
During the peak of wedding season, the number of guests allowed was reduced to 50. This was to curb the second wave of virus spread.
Usually in sort of the, conventional, wedding scenario, whatever. There's a build-up, right? There's a build-up of these events which are happening. People are constantly meeting. There's some sort of dance which is being practiced. Mm. So you sort of get into this wedding mode and there's going to be a celebration at the end of it. That was incredibly muted.
And non-existent, actually.
Yeah, it was just 5-6 people meeting, essentially,
In a garden.
Doing
dance practice.
So it wasn't a big sort of thing, which I think was missed.
It seemed we woke up one day, today's our wedding, opposed to weeks of dance practices that happened. There was also an element of anxiety with everything going on the side. What if somebody does get sick at the wedding? What if somebody gets sick before the wedding? you know, no, I don't want it on my conscience, and I wouldn't want anybody to get exposed to any sort of illness at the wedding.
We sort of had a chat between us. So listen, what happens if somebody tests positive?
Yeah, someone we've been in contact with and we may have been exposed.
Only in such a situation we would go ahead and postpone the wedding. We don't want this thing to sort of spread or our event to become this, you know, super spreader of some kind.
India has shown the second largest number of COVID cases in the world, but that hasn't stopped its wedding spree. India's capital, Delhi, saw the most number of weddings in November and December of 2020, more than half of all weddings that year. The wedding industry, while struggling, continues to survive because of people's motivation to get married. But with it comes the COVID surge.
Some people told us is that maybe you'd want to ask people to get tested before the wedding.
Yeah, but that's a very uncomfortable conversation to have, especially when in the wedding context where you're supposed to be like, "Aap aaiye," you know, and all, and suddenly I'm asking you to get tested before you can come to my event, which sort of goes against the traditional notion of being a host and guest. So it is slightly uncomfortable, but it's important that you have these conversations, and people also need to take more responsibility that if you are showing symptoms, don't go to these events.
Yeah.
It is fine. There will be other opportunities. By the end of it, we're just glad it happened. I mean, we're together, we have this nice place of our own, our parents are happy. Yeah. Everybody walked away from the event healthy, happy, nothing happened.
Welcome to the very glamorous life of a wedding planner. We are currently in Silampur market. This is one of the biggest wholesale fabric markets in Delhi. For 6 months, the market was completely shut, and only in the past 2 months, slowly, gradually, we see the market opening up again. So finally, we've come back today to see if our old vendors are open again and take a look and get some supplies. When I started my company called Plan Vinonia, I wanted to make a forte in the whole concept of little weddings and, you know, more personalized and smaller weddings. And the whole identity of the brand just came through that. Post-lockdown, the intimate weddings and the small wedding concept came up. It was very easy actually for my company to evolve into that because we were already doing something on those lines. But the bigger problem that we actually faced was that we have bigger wedding planners and people who are more in the industry for like 40, 50 years. And they were doing weddings of a much higher scale. They started doing smaller weddings, so automatically they became our competition. The entire structure and the foundation of the entire event for us comes from the fabrics we choose. So I personally like to come here and do the sourcing and the sampling, and we take cuttings, for example, of these, and then we take it back. And we take numbers of these guys and then they send it to us as much as the quantity is, depending upon the design we choose. Yeah, bante 6 mahine ke liye.
2 mahine ke liye.
2 mahine ke liye aata. Ya
fir sara chalu ho gaya. Agar sab chalu hai ye.
Log aa rahe hain.
Thoda farak to hai ye.
Ha, kam ho gaya
business. Kam hai.
The other big issue that I feel like the entire wedding community is facing is the big backbone and the foundation of our entire business is the laborers who work with us. They are the ones who are working the entire night on the set and making the place look like how it is. But when the whole lockdown situation was declared, the labor basically got out of job. They all automatically wanted to go back to their villages or hometowns, and because they couldn't pay to live in a city like Delhi, because of which the labor itself has become very expensive for us. What used to normally cost us about 1200, 1500 per day is now charging us 2000, 2500 per day for the labor. When you book a venue, you don't just do the decor in half the space. The area of the decor is still the same. The number of hours that me and my team are putting in the entire wedding is still the same. Just because the guests have gone lower, people just assume that it means the entire budget has gone down. But it's become really tough for us to make the client understand this as a point of view. Wedding coming in the next 2 days, so we've come today to place the orders for that. बीस का है कितना किलो? 3 किलो। कितने का चल रहा है
आजकल? ये इस वक्त 10 रुपये बन गए।
यू गेट होलसेल रेट्स इन हियर। प्रीटी मच ऑल द फ्लावर्स दैट यू सी इन द वेडिंग कल्चर कम्स फ्रॉम दिस मार्केट इटसेल्फ। दिस मार्केट स्टार्ट्स अराउंड 2 AM एंड बाय 7 AM लिटरली ऑल ऑफ दिस प्लेस इज एम्प्टी। सो व्हेन द होल लॉकडाउन हैपेंड अ लॉट ऑफ फ्लावर्स व्हिच यूज्ड टू बी अवेलेबल वेरी इजीली टू अस अर्लियर हैव नाउ बिकम वेरी एक्सक्लूसिव एंड द कॉस्टिंग एंड द प्राइसिंग फॉर देम हैज गॉन हाई। सो व्हाट अ फ्लावर अरेंजमेंट नॉर्मली वुड कॉस्ट अस अराउंड 400 to 500 नाउ कम्स टू अस अबाउट 1000 to 1200। सो वी सी लाइक अ बिग ड्रास्टिक चेंज इन टू द कॉस्टिंग ऑफ द होल थिंग। क्या जाता है 120 रुपये? सही जा रहा है भाई आपका बिजनेस?
काम ही नहीं चले थे।
कितने दिन बंद था?
6 महीने।
6 महीने बंद था ना? अब उतना हो रहा है जितना पहले हो रहा था?
जैसे पहले जैसे मंडी था उतना है नहीं बिल्कुल। उसके 4% मतलब 25% काम रह गए।
25%?
हाँ, मतलब एक हल्का सा मतलब पेट रोटी दाल रोटी मिल रहा है बस। कुछ लोग चला गया बिल्कुल, काम ही नहीं चला उनकी।
The seasonal nature of wedding business has left the wedding venue owners struggling as well. In the grand scheme of big fat Indian weddings, securing venues is usually a tough game. But in the pandemic year, COVID regulations moved around and owners of these usually hot properties found themselves in hotter water. Yashika Sharma, the director of a mid-range 3-star property, has found it tough to make the ends meet.
This is one of the 5 venues we have for wedding purpose here. This particular venue, we used to do a lot of weddings out here, like a lot of small wedding functions. All the residential weddings out here used to be very lively. Now it has gone tremendously low. We don't see much people. This actually was the most liveliest place. This was the place where we used to have pool mandaps. It all started with my sister's wedding. It had become a trend at that time that people used to do their weddings at DMarks, and it actually makes me sad to see this entire place like this. And I don't know when we are going to get back to the normal now. This is the Royal. It can accommodate around 300 to 500 packs. It's huge actually to accommodate 50 pack people, which is like way below the number for this particular area. In 50 packs, we won't even be able to wear the entire cost. It is really a huge, huge loss for a hotelier. See, a 3-star or a 4-star or a 2-star property, how they're different from a 5-star is they actually look forward more to the wedding season. People with middle income group, they are actually, they could do a proper lavish wedding at a 3-star. And 5-stars are only targeted by the high end. And we have a lot of people in Delhi in particular who belong to that middle, upper middle and lower middle income group. So now 5-stars are giving under 5 lakh rupees package for the wedding. Like a 3-star is going to give you a under 3 lakh package. Why won't a person go to a 5-star rather than come to a 3-star now? Last month I had 2 residential weddings. And this month I have around 5 residential weddings. In 2020, I'd like managed to get around 15 in total. Whereas initially it was like 15 in a month. For 2nd and 3rd December, I had this wedding for 275 packs. I pushed them from April to December. Now again, just 5 days back, they put another restriction on 50 packs. So they had like 300 packs to 500 packs wedding. And they're saying no. We are not going to do the wedding now. We have to follow the regulation, they have to follow the regulation. So it's difficult for both of us. Government should actually give some kind of hope to the hospitality industry. And people in general should also be, you know, taking care of wearing the mask and personal hygiene and everything. Rather than just shutting everything down and making it worse for other people. Because see, this is one industry where different people are linked up to. Like you have different vendors linked up to. You have like caterers, you have like DJ person. Everybody has been linked up to this particular industry and everybody is going suffering.
Planning a wedding during these times itself is an uphill task. But couples like Deeksha and Jatin had multiple reasons to go through with it.
We realized that we wanted to stay together once the lockdown happened. We didn't meet each other for months together and I didn't want to put my parents' life at risk. So the only way both of us could stay together was to, you know, eventually get married and stay together. So we thought, you know, why not do it? Why not do a small ceremony?
We had decided earlier that we'll get married in Goa with not more than 150 people.
So he loves beaches and he's from the hills, I'm from Bangalore. Goa is midway. And a lot of factors actually. It's my dad's favorite spot for a vacation. So, you know, he's been asking for quotations from places since I don't know when, since my childhood, I guess, that I want my daughter to get married in Goa, but that's not happening because of the pandemic. It's been quite a task, I would say, because from shopping
to managing everything, everything that is being done is being done online and on the calls.
I haven't really visited a spa or a parlor in months. I would have wanted all my friends to fly out of Bangalore, all my family friends I've grown up with and planned my wedding with practically. My paternal grandparents won't be able to make it because, you know, they're very old and both of them are quite ill to travel. I was like, you know, let's not put their health at risk. It's not a very good idea. We can probably host a reception later when things get normal. Another thing that is of a major concern during this entire event is my mother is a kidney transplant patient and she's taken the kidney from my grandmother and both of them are going to be present at the wedding. So they're basically people with comorbidities as defined in the guidelines by the government. And that's why we want to be extremely careful around them.
So first and foremost, what we have done is we haven't allowed more than 80, 85 people. Although the limit is probably 150 to 200,
175
in Chandigarh.
We've drafted an SOP sort of a thing. We have sent it to everyone saying, please wear masks at all times, maintain social distancing, don't get carried away just because you want to take pictures and, yeah, you know, dance around. Another thing that we made sure was, all the wedding functions are actually in outdoor spaces, even though it's going to be really cold in Chandigarh.
But you have to manage with that, you have to.
We were discussing the other day, you know, people have wedding jitters, yeah, and stuff. We don't have time for wedding
exactly.
jitters. Exactly. We have other concerns. We're like, oh my God, everyone should be healthy and safe.
Many like Deeksha and Jatin have had to work around the changing situation because of the pandemic. But with no real end in sight till there is a global vaccination, they may have to just persevere and look at the brighter side.
There's always a good side to everything. I personally feel that there's going to be a shift, a paradigm shift, in which the spends would be getting reduced. So all this complaint of various communities, of various elders, that the weddings in India are really obnoxious and the wastage should be curtailed, is eventually, in any case, happened through a natural circumstance and a natural scenario.
Is there something that you would like to tell people who plan to get married?
I think if you are, like, it'll do you well to have lower expectations. Only because there are things you'll have to give up from what you had imagined as like your perfect wedding. And that's okay, because at the end of the day, you'll still have a great time.